Good morning. Welcome to Arlington Street Church, gathered in love and service for justice and peace. Welcome to the Soul of Sunday. We are Unitarian Universalists. Ours is a historic faith with a progressive theology. We affirm the worth and dignity of every being, and that we are all deeply interconnected. We are bound to one another not by creed, but by covenant. And we are called to answer the call of love with open minds, open hearts, and open hands. Whoever you are, those of all nations, all creeds, all colors, all kinds of love, you are welcome here. As we gather, we acknowledge that Arlington Street Church occupies the ancestral homeland of the Massachusetts. By making this land acknowledgement, we recognize, honor, and affirm the sovereignty of all First Nations peoples. Dear ones, welcome Zoomers, and welcome Incarnate Congregation. You all look beautiful. I want to say a very special thank you to our volunteers here in the sanctuary today. Tech team, Chala Hazar, Jen Eno, Cam Moorhead, Richard Brew, and Sandy Dixon. You are awesome. Thank you, friends, so much. Thank you to the Great Doors team, ensuring that we're gathering safely in person. Queen Cheryl, Barbara Ginhart, and Rachel Corey are our greeters. And Bill Briggs and Keith Perrin are our lead ushers. No, I think Philip is our lead usher today. Is it true, Philip? You're looking very island back there. It's awesome. Welcome, sweetie. Thank you. Thank you to our musicians, Director of Music Mark David Buckles, guest pianist Tyler Turner, backed by popular demand. Welcome home, Tyler. Great to see you. Julie Metcalf on violin. Our section leaders, Beck Zare, Daniel Rosenzweig, Hannah Shanefield, and Joel Clemens. Welcome, Joel. And the Arlington Street Church Choir. Our worship coordinator is Lucy Humphrey. Dan Simpson is in training. Welcome, Dan. And our beloved executive minister, Beth Robbins, is both in the Zoom room, holding the space for us as one beloved community, and up in the cuckoo's nest next to the organ loft. Great to see you, honey. Some of our singers rapid test in this morning so they can sing unmasked. We've closed the first four pews up front to keep everyone safe. A reminder that those in the sanctuary should be physically distancing from those who are not in your family or pod. And when your pew is full, please close your pew door so people who arrive after you know that it's full, even if you're the only one sitting there. And finally, for those of you who are new to Arlington Street, I want to say a very special welcome. Those of you in the sanctuary, there are welcome cards in the pew racks. Please hand yours to an usher or to anyone at the great doors as you leave. There's also a basket there. And those of you in the Zoom room, please fill out a connection card. The link is in the chat. It includes the option to request the link to a recording of today's sermon. Since I can't reach all of you in person after the service, I'd love to follow up with a virtual hello. Whether you've been coming here for years or today is your first time at Arlington Street, welcome home.
Good morning.
Morning, Luz.
If you haven't already downloaded today's order of service, it's available in the chat and on the homepage at ascboston.org. For our guests here in the sanctuary, there are printed copies at the great doors. Also on the homepage, you'll find a link to Sermon Bingo. Feel free to play along while Reverend Kim preaches. As we begin our greetings, I invite the Zoomers and those here in the sanctuary with a handy device to please say hello in the chat and tell us where you're Zooming in from today. And now, Rich is going to turn the camera on the Incarnate congregation as we wave and smile at each other, as well as at our friends in the Zoom room. And you all in the Zoom room can wave and smile back. Hello, friends. Let's all engage that Arlington Street spirit of welcome that transcends physical distance as we greet one another heart to heart.
Good morning, everyone. Our opening hymn is Morning Has Broken, hymn number 38 in your gray Seeing the Living Tradition books, if you have them. And the lyrics are printed in the order service and available in the chat. I invite you to rise in body, rise in spirit, and let's sing this lovely hymn. Julie's gonna take it away on the violin. Here we go. Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Pray
Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for the springing, fresh from the world. Sweet the rain's new fall, sunlit from heaven. Like the first dewfall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where God's feet pass. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light Eden saw play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new day.
Treasured ritual of sharing community candles of sorrow and joy. These candles were submitted on our website by the Friday evening deadline. If you didn't submit your candle and have a joy or sorrow to share this morning, please wait until the third candle is lit, the silent candle, and then type your joy or sorrow into the chat. Zoomers are invited to light silent candles at home. Those in the sanctuary are invited to light a silent candle at the table up front to the right of the Gleason podium. In addition to sharing our sorrows and joys this morning, let's reach out to one another in the week ahead, staying connected. May these times remind us of how very precious this beloved community is. We need one another. Whether together or apart, may we stay very close. And now, in the spirit of invocation, let's join in singing Sanctuary. The words are printed in your order of service and in the chat.
Some of us come today with heavy hearts. We open our hearts to you.
This is a candle of sorrow from the congregation. Our poor Kim broke her wrist this week. We would like to compliment you on the excellent color choice of your purple cast. Just in time for Pride Month and wishing you a speedy recovery. our final candle of sorrow is a candle of sorrow for the families of those who lost their lives in Buffalo and for the persistence of gun violence and deadly racism in this country.
From Martha Favre, I would like to submit a candle of healing for Harriet Currie Ranvig and anyone else that is dealing with issues of AFib. And our final candle of joy from Don Richter. Good news, a unanimous vote. A special commission voted to seek total redesign of MA's state flag and seal. We might get rid of the indigenous person with a sword over his head.
In our hearts, we light a silent candle to remember and to rejoice. May the peace of this sanctuary enter into our hearts as we share this quiet moment together, breathing our prayers for ourselves, for one another, for our country, and for the world.
Let's now join in saying together the affirmation and covenant of this beloved spiritual community. The words are printed in your order of service and in the chat. Love is the spirit of this congregation, and service is our gift. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to speak our truths in love, and to help one another. El amor es el espíritu de nuestra congregación, y el servicio es nuestro regalo. Esto es a lo que nos prometemos, convivir en paz, hablar nuestras verdades con amor y ayudarnos los unos a los otros. And now let's join together in singing hymn number 12, O Life That Maketh All Things New. Please rise in body and in spirit.
Thank you.
all the things. War and peace, hunger and gluttony, tragedy and beauty. How can we get our arms around it all? Especially when it's happening all at once. We are at once storm-tossed and in the doldrums and safely on shore, sitting under a palm tree on a white sand beach with a cool drink and a good book. We can't hold it all at once. Best to surrender and accept that it's always all the things. American poet Adrienne Rich wrote, "No one ever told us we had to study our lives, make of our lives a study as if learning natural history or music, that we should begin with the simple exercises first and slowly go on trying the hard ones, practicing till strength and accuracy become one with the daring to leap into the transcendence, take the chance of breaking down in the wild arpeggio or faulting the full sentence of the fugue." And in fact, we can't live like that. We take on everything at once before we've even begun to read or mark time. We're forced to begin in the midst of the hardest movement, the one already sounding as we are born. As I was planning a wedding with a young couple, they asked me to take out the line, "Until death do us part." We don't want to think about dying on our wedding day. As we spoke further, it turned out that the groom's grandfather had died recently, and the bride's mother had died when she was young. They were both very sad that these two had not lived to be a part of their ceremony. I suggested we set up a small table with photos, and that I mention grandfather and mother and affirm that surely they were with us in spirit. The couple wasn't having it. "We don't want to be sad on our wedding day." The day came, the service began, and I watched as the groom's grandmother was seated alone, and the bride's father walked her down the aisle and then sat down alone. They were doing their best, but both were in tears before I had even begun to speak. And then both bride and groom were also awash in tears, undone not at the miracle of their love or for all the joy of the day, but because they whispered to me they were missing their mother and their grandfather. It occurred to me then that no day is ever without the threat of death parting us. No day is ever without sadness. And it helps. It really does help simply to name that, to name that it's always all the things. Had we acknowledged it at the outset, the unbearable pressure of bottling it up might have been made manageable. The spiritual practice is to surrender, accept, and say so. This is painful. And this is beautiful. To take a deeper dive, this is the essence of the Buddha's first noble truth. Pain is inevitable. Suffering is optional. Everyone feels pain. What we do with that pain is up to us. My friend, Jewish Buddhist teacher Sylvia Boorstein, loves to joke that the first line of Dr. Scott Peck's book, The Road Less Traveled, was what sold more than 6.5 million copies and made it an international bestseller. The first line, just these words: "Life is difficult." I sometimes think people read that first sentence, says Sylvia, and were so excited someone was actually telling the truth of their experience that they bought the book. It was, of course, plagiarism. The Buddha said it first. I have often thought of a very different time, a very difficult time in Sylvia's life, and how it set her on the path to spiritual awakening, as only difficult times can. She was in her mid-30s, happily married to Seymour, a young mother of four, and a successful psychologist. She says, "Somehow I never thought about how vulnerable it all was." And then one morning, two little girls were on their way to school, sisters, age 6 and 7, classmates of Sylvia's daughter, Elizabeth, and they were killed by an out-of-control car. Suddenly, Sylvia says, "I woke up to the fact that being alive is very dangerous, and every moment of life is very precious. Perhaps if I had awakened to that fact in a balanced way, or at least in a more mature way, I would have experienced one of those transformative moments one reads about, after which one is totally changed forever and the rest of their life is lived in abiding clarity. That didn't happen to me. I was," she says, "plunged into despair. I couldn't imagine why people continued living if life is terminal at the very best and unpredictable throughout. I realized all relationships end in loss, and loss is so painful. I read existential philosophers Camus and Sartre, and I wondered, how could people live their lives as if everything were all right when I absolutely knew it wasn't? Part of my despair," Sylvia Boorstein concludes, "was thinking I was the only person who felt that way. What a relief it was to go to my first meditation retreat and hear people speak the truth so clearly, the first noble truth, that life is difficult and painful, and not because we're doing it wrong. But pain and despair are never the whole of the human story. We know that. Depending on where it catches us, the good news or the bad news is that everything changes. Everything is always in flux. The longing for lasting pleasure or lasting security is absolutely at odds with the fact that we're part of a dynamic system in which everything, everything and everyone is always in process. Fundamentalism is comforting ourselves by getting some neat way of explaining reality in a death grip and refusing to tolerate the discomfort of staying open to other possibilities. With a fixed identity, we have to busy ourselves with trying to rearrange reality because reality doesn't conform to our fundamentalist view. The question then, the spiritual challenge, is how to increase our tolerance for instability and change and live wholeheartedly in spite of impermanence. American Tibetan Buddhist nun Pema Chodron speaks of the fundamental anxiety or queasiness of being human. She writes, "What if we said, yes, this is the way it is, this is what it means to be human, and just decided to sit down and enjoy the ride? We know we can't get our arms around all the things, but can we make it our mission to make them into vehicles at best? Make them, everyone and everything in our path, a vehicle to live with a measure of peace and grace?" Rumi says, "How long will we fill our pockets like children with dirt and stones? Let the world go. Holding it, we never know ourselves, are never airborne." A normally healthy friend of American Buddhist teacher Sharon Salzberg got very sick with pneumonia. Independently, two different mutual friends called in rapid succession to tell Sharon he'd almost died. By the time she reached him, she joked, "I may now expressly refer to you as he who almost died." And without missing a beat, her friend responded, "Well, that's better than being known as he who almost lived." We can spend a lifetime almost living rather than being truly alive. Of course, there's an alternative, staying stuck in almost living. Echoing the Buddha, Pema Chodron writes, "It's not impermanence per se that's the cause of our suffering. Rather, it's our resistance. Our discomfort arises from all our efforts to realize our dream of constant okayness. When we resist change, it's called suffering. But when we completely let go and not struggle against it, when we embrace the groundlessness of our situation and relax into its dynamic quality, that, my friends, is called enlightenment. Another word for this is freedom. Freedom from struggling against the foundational ambiguity of being human." So let's lean into Rumi's idea of being airborne. For starters, it is said to be a sign of enlightenment when someone can say, "Well, this isn't what I want, but it's what I got. So, okay. Okay." Can we find that equanimity in ourselves? A friend of a friend described his lovely mother-in-law driving on a Los Angeles freeway, infamously smoggy, congested, and miserable, exclaiming cheerfully, "Wow, look at all these people going places." Maybe she's a Buddha. This is reframing. It's helpful. Pema Chodron tells the story of standing on the prow of a large ship with her 12-year-old son, think Titanic. He was having the time of his life, but she was compelled to admit to him that her fear of heights was getting the best of her. She describes some of what she was feeling, including that her legs were turning to mush. And her son said, "Mom, that's exactly how I feel." Reframing, same physical sensation, but one is miserable and one is airborne. Canadian singer and songwriter Leonard Cohen sang, "Suzanne takes your hand, she leads you to the river. She's wearing rags and feathers from Salvation Army counters, and the sun pours down like honey on Our Lady of the Harbor, and she shows you where to look among the garbage and the flowers." The garbage and the flowers. In Tibetan Buddhism, there are three instructions for looking among the garbage and the flowers, for living beautifully in the mess. The instructions are actually directives known as the three commitments, taken as vows. The first vow is to do your best, not to cause harm. The work is to attend to our thoughts and emotions and to refrain from acting with clouded vision. Do your best. The second vow is to help others, to keep our minds and hearts and hands open to all beings. Help others. The third vow is to resolve to embrace the world exactly as it is, without bias, to experience everything we encounter as a means to awakening. Do your best. Help others. Embrace the world exactly as it is. shared a little of the work of brain scientist Jill Bolt Taylor, who documented in excruciating detail exactly what was happening as she suffered a massive stroke and during her long recovery. Her book is called My Stroke of Insight. One of many very cool things she shares is that our physiological response to an emotion lasts exactly 90 seconds. It takes 1.5 minutes for us to process an emotion from the moment we're triggered until it's fully run its course. If the feeling lasts any longer, it's because we are fueling it with our thoughts, recycling the storyline. What should last for 1.5 minutes can last 10 years, 30 years, more. One woman ran with this information and came up with what she calls the 1.5 minute thing. We know exactly where she's going with this. When we feel thrown, emotionally destabilized, queasy, or overwrought, when we can't get our arms around it all, we can remember and practice the 1.5 minute thing. Surrender, drop the storyline, stay present, and let go. Beloved spiritual companions, let's close with this. Profoundly touched and moved by the 13th century Persian poet and Sufi mystic, Coleman Barks brought Rumi to the English-speaking world with this translation of The Guest House. This being human is a guest house. Every morning, a new arrival, a joy, a depression, a meanness, some momentary awareness comes as an unexpected visitor. Welcome and entertain them all. Even if they are a crowd of sorrows who violently sweep your house empty of its furniture, still treat each guest honorably. They may be clearing you out for some new delight. The dark thought, the shame, the malice, meet them at the door laughing and invite them in. Be grateful. Be grateful for whatever comes, because each has been sent as a guide from beyond. Amen.
Pain is inevitable, suffering is optional. When I heard Reverend Kim would be preaching about this, I thought of the lyrics of this gorgeous Brahms piece, the May Night. In it, the speaker, though awash in the beauty of a May evening, is experiencing something we're all familiar with, pain. Yet within the poem, there's also joy. Somewhere hid in the leaves, two softly cooing doves fill my heart with delight. And personally, I'm struck by the moment after this, when they say, yet do I turn away, turn to shadows that are darker. Basically, in a moment of joy, they decide that they'd rather wallow in their misery. Relatable? Suffering is optional. And yet, I get it. We're so desperately wanting people to see and acknowledge our pain. So we write songs and poetry. And somewhere, years hence, someone might hear these words or sing them, might directly experience their emotions and know their pain is acknowledged.
Arlington Street Church is entirely self-sustaining. It's up to us, and our generosity continues to be astounding. Thank you for your commitment to our staff, our building, and our beloved spiritual community. I'm finishing up my second year at Wellesley College with a project where I looked at the relationship between Unitarian Universalism and the struggle for Black liberation. And there's lots of moving coming up for me. This summer, I'll be working in D.C. for Representative Jake Auchincloss for Massachusetts 4th Congressional District. And in the fall, I will be studying abroad in Athens. Wherever I go, I will be taking Arlington Street with me. Please take a moment now to join me in giving to our beloved spiritual community and filling our virtual collection plate. You can mail a check to the church or use the envelopes in the pews, which can be handed to Reverend Kim, Reverend Beth, or to any other ushers after the service. You can give online by scanning the QR code in the order of service or by going to ascboston.org. Or you can also text your gift to the church by sending a message with the word GIVE, G-I-V-E, to 617-300-0509. Each Sunday, we share our collection plate with a partner in our mission of love, service, justice, and peace. Today, we're supporting the Lily House, a community hospice house giving end-of-life care at no charge so that none of us needs to die alone. Our own Mary Gilatch will be double-matching our gifts. You can read more about it in the order of service. Thank you for your generosity.
Reverend Kim spoke earlier about embracing the groundlessness of life, and there is no piece that speaks that to me more than this one.
Let me lift from the ground till my soul is in flight. Let me sway like the shade of a tree. Let me swirl like a cloud in a storm on the sea. Wish me on my way through the dawning day. I wanna flow, wanna rise, wanna spill, wanna grow in a groove side of a hill. I don't care if the train runs late, if the checks don't clear, if the house blows down. I'll be off where the weeds run wild, where the seeds fall far from this earthbound town. And I'll start to soar. Watch me rain till I pour. I'll catch a ship that'll sail me astray. Get caught in a wind, I'll just have to obey till I'm flying away. Ah, 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 ah. Let me leave behind all the clouds in my mind. I want to wake without wondering why, finding myself in a berth for the sky. I'll just roll. Let me lose all control. I want to float like a wish in a is the sound of the sea in a shell. I don't know, but maybe I'm just a fool. I should keep to the ground. I should stay where I'm at. Maybe everyone has hunger like this, and the hunger will pass, but I can't think like that. All I know is somewhere through clearing, there's a flickering of sunlight on a river long and wide. And I have such a river inside. on the sea, wish me on my way. Shift like a wave rolling on, wanna drift from the path I've been traveling upon. Before I am gone. There
are weekly gatherings in the Zoom room for loving kindness, meditation, poetry, yoga, and writing. Every Wednesday, Reverend Kim and Reverend Beth host a tea party with its conversation prompt. This week's prompt is describe a time a stranger helped you. In addition, this afternoon at 12:30, the transformation team for racial justice will lead a discussion of Layla Saad's Me and White Supremacy. On Wednesday afternoon, join Professor Alan Helms and Reverend Kim to savor the provocative and witty poetry of Polish poet Maria Zimborska. All of these gatherings are in various Zoom rooms. Information and links are at ascboston.org. To attend any of them, you don't have to be a member. You don't have to turn on your video or talk if you don't want to, and they're all free. All are always welcome. Following the service, everyone is welcome to join the virtual coffee hour. If you'd like to participate, please answer yes to the breakout room invitation that will appear on your screen. Reverend Kim will be out front. If you're here in person, please come say hello after the virtual coffee hour. Thanks to all of you who joined in today's service and to all those who made it possible. Remember, we're all in this together. And now, let us rise in body and rise in spirit and join in singing You'll Never Walk Alone. It will be led by Joel Clemens.
Thank you.
Before our benediction, I invite those of you in the Zoom room to please reach out your hands and touch the sides of your square. And those of you in the sanctuary to please raise your hands, palms out. Let's send loving kindness to the people to your left and to your right. Send loving kindness on either side of you to the people on either side of them. Send out love into this beloved spiritual community and feel it coming back to you. Love is the spirit of this congregation. And now for our benediction, I invite you to put your hands over your heart in namaste. I bow to the divine in you. The words of W.E.B. Du Bois, born in 1868, co-founder of the NAACP, the first African-American to earn a doctorate from Harvard. It is the wind and the rain, O God, the cold and the storm that make this earth to blossom and bear its fruit. So in our lives, it is storm and stress and hurt and suffering that make us bring the world's work to its highest perfection. Let us learn then in these growing years to respect the harder, sterner aspects of life together with its joy and laughter, and to weave them all into the great web. Let us keep this faith, beloveds, and pass it on. The service begins when the service ends. Bless your hearts. I love you. Amen.
Please visit ascboston.org for more information about this historic Unitarian Universalist congregation. Arlington Street Church, gathered in love and service for justice and peace.